and I'm delighted to be with you this morning to preside over a discussion with the First Minister of Scotland. Nicola Sturgeon was elected Deputy Leader of the Scottish National Party, the SNP, in 2004, and in that capacity, she went on to become a high-profile figure in the Scottish Parliament and Scottish politics, leading to her history-making election as Leader of the SNP in November of last year. She became the first woman to hold the position First Minister of Scotland. But she made further history 2 months ago after a vigorous campaign when her party won a landslide in the UK general elections, capturing 56 of 59 seats designated for Scotland in the National Parliament. She will begin by making remarks, and then I'll sit down with her for a conversation before we take your questions. Please join me in welcoming the First Minister of Scotland, Nicola Sturgeon.
Thank you very much indeed, Judy, for that very warm introduction. Thank you to all of you for being here this morning. It is a real pleasure for me to be here. It's a real pleasure for me to be here in the United States, here in Washington, D.C., and in particular to be here at the Council on Foreign Relations, an august and well-respected organisation, not just in the United States, but worldwide. One of the things I've been reminded of often since I arrived on this visit to the US at the weekend is the fact that the bonds, the very deep bonds between Scotland and the United States go back centuries. They run from the discussion and the debate between Enlightenment thinkers such as David Hume and Benjamin Franklin to the modern exchange of university graduates and the connections between our technology companies. The relationship between our two countries is cultural, it is social, it is historic, and of course, it is economic as well. And we value those links and those ties very highly. And from what I've seen and observed on my visit this week is that those ties are set to continue and indeed to strengthen for generations to come. So it is a real pleasure to be here this morning at the Council on Foreign Relations, an organisation which for more than 90 years has contributed to that exchange of ideas between the United States and the wider world. I'm especially pleased to be speaking at this particular time. I'm very aware that there is a strong interest here in political developments, not just in Scotland, but across the United Kingdom as a whole. And there is, understandably, an interest in the implications of these developments for Europe and for the wider international community. Before we begin our discussion, therefore, I want to provide a very brief overview of my thoughts on where the United Kingdom and Scotland stand right now. And in doing that, I'll talk about two referendums and one election. I'll look back briefly at the referendum on Scottish independence that took place last year, and also at the UK general election that took place just last month. But I'll also look forward to the referendum on the United Kingdom's membership of the European Union, which is expected to take place sometime before the end of 2017, although the exact timing of that referendum is not yet determined. Now, as you've probably guessed, or as you're probably able to guess, the first referendum on Scottish independence, which took place last September, didn't turn out exactly as I would have hoped that it would. But while that referendum might not have transformed Scotland's constitutional position, it undoubtedly transformed Scottish politics, and I would argue it has had a transformational effect on United Kingdom politics as well. Firstly, that referendum has made Scotland one of the most politically engaged countries, I would argue, in the entire world. Nearly everybody in Scotland last year became intensely involved in a peaceful and passionate debate about the kind of country they wanted to live in. And that debate has had lasting consequences. For example, in the UK general election last month, turnout, voter turnout in Scotland was some 5 percentage points higher than it was in the rest of the United Kingdom. Many people who perhaps previously hadn't had any interest whatsoever in politics or how the country was governed now understand that their vote and their voice really matters. They feel involved in decision making in a way that hasn't happened before, certainly not in my lifetime. So regardless of the result, the referendum itself, the experience of the referendum has been good for Scotland. We're more energised, more informed, and more empowered than we have ever been before. The result of that referendum also provided part of the context for last month's UK general election. To the casual observer, the UK election produced a very clear result. It resulted in the election of a majority Conservative government and saw the return of David Cameron as Prime Minister. But when you look at that election result in more detail, something striking and much more complex emerges. Because in many ways, there were actually 4 different elections taking place in the United Kingdom last month in each of the different nations of the United Kingdom. And those elections produced very different results. And the differences in those results have very significant implications for the UK, for the future of the UK and how it is governed as a country. So my party, the Scottish National Party, won the election in Scotland with, as Judy has just told you, 56 out of the 59 electoral constituencies in Scotland. Labour won the election in Wales. The Conservatives won in England with 60% of the seats there. And of course, Northern Ireland has and always had had a very different system of party politics. So there was no one uniform result across the United Kingdom. The multinational United Kingdom voted in 4 very different ways. And shortly before the election, I raised the question of what actually constitutes an electoral mandate in the UK when the 4 nations are voting in and pulling in very different directions. In practical terms, of course, simply winning enough votes and seats in England can secure a parliamentary majority. But when a government is achieved only by winning seats in 1 of the 4 nations of the UK, the question arises, what kind of mandate is that? The Conservative Party, of course, has the right to form the government of the UK and has indeed done that. But it was not the biggest party in 3 of the 4 nations of the UK, far from it, in fact. And so the legitimacy of its actions in those other nations comes very clearly into focus. And so, as I discussed with the Prime Minister when we met after the election, what happens to the future of the United Kingdom now in the years ahead will, at least in part, depend upon how responsively Westminster deals with the reality that in political as well as in constitutional terms, the UK is not a unitary state. There is no second Scottish independence referendum on the immediate horizon, of course, but I do think it is a reasonable point to make that if the United Kingdom is to remain intact in the years to come, it must demonstrate, and it must demonstrate very clearly, that it can adapt to multinational and multi-party politics in a far more substantial manner than it has often done in the past. Now, here in the United States, of course, you're very used to the idea of 50 different state governments making very different choices about very significant issues. But that's not something that UK governments are used to. For much of the last century, devolution notwithstanding, the UK has been a remarkably centralised state. But it's now increasingly clear that for the United Kingdom as a whole, one size doesn't fit all, and a one size fits all approach is not going to fit the bill for the future. Of course, the distinct political identities which seem to be emerging in different parts of the UK are also relevant to the third vote that I want to briefly talk about this morning, the coming referendum on the UK's membership of the European Union, something that is of huge significance within the UK, but as I found in the United States this week, a matter of considerable interest to people here as well. What many people back in the UK find quite odd about this referendum is that the Prime Minister says he wants to stay in the European Union. Both of the biggest UK parties say they want to stay in the European Union. There's overwhelming support, or so it seems, for European Union membership in the Westminster Parliament. And yet here we are in the United Kingdom standing perilously close to the exit door of the EU. And interestingly, those who the Prime Minister is seeking to appease with a European referendum, the Eurosceptic opinion in his own party or the United Kingdom Independence Party, are unlikely to be appeased by a renegotiated membership of the European Union. What that body of opinion wants is for the UK to exit the European Union and nothing less. If it seems odd in the UK as a whole, and it often does, that this referendum is now looming, the UK government's approach seems especially odd to many people in Scotland. In the general election last month, across the whole of the UK, parties which want to leave the European Union polled around 12% of the popular vote. In Scotland, that figure was less than 2%. And just this week, we've seen an opinion poll of Scottish voters showing that 72% would opt to vote to remain in the European Union, with only 28% saying they would vote to leave. And that's perhaps not surprising, given the economic significance both to Scotland and to the UK of our EU membership. In Scotland alone, for example, there are some 300,000 jobs that rely on our exports to the European Union. So membership of the European Union is of enormous importance. So I would argue for many people in Scotland, the referendum on the EU simply isn't a priority. But nevertheless, it does raise the possibility, depending on how the result goes across the UK, that Scotland could be taken out of the European Union against our will. And that's why the European question is in some ways very directly linked to the question of how the UK is governed. One of the themes of the Scottish referendum last year, articulated often very powerfully by those campaigning against Scottish independence, was that Scotland is a valued and equal partner in a UK family of nations. And so surely, therefore, as many people in Scotland would say, it shouldn't be possible for Scotland's voice to be overruled in an EU referendum. And that's why the Scottish government is arguing for a double majority provision in that referendum, where the UK could only leave the EU if each of the nations of the UK votes to leave. That sort of territorial requirement, of course, is often used in federal countries like Canada and Australia. And I think it's time to apply it to the United Kingdom, a multinational state, to give meaning to the sense that the UK is a family of nations. I said last week in a speech to the European Policy Centre in Brussels that if Scotland does find itself taken out of the European Union against a vote in Scotland to remain in, then it could produce a demand for another independence referendum, which may well be unstoppable. But I would argue, and do argue, that the UK government has it within their power to remove that possibility by agreeing to the double majority provision that we're putting forward. The referendum legislation could demonstrate what we are so often told, that the UK government does see the UK as a family of nations. And I would posit that that would be one very clear way in which the UK could do what I suggested earlier it needs to do, demonstrate that it can adapt to a multinational, multi-party system of politics within the United Kingdom. So just to conclude my opening remarks, it's clear from what I've said, I think it's clear from observing politics in the United Kingdom, that these are momentous and very exciting times for Scotland and indeed for the UK as a whole. That brings challenges, but it also brings considerable opportunities. The coming months and the coming years gives us a chance to secure greater autonomy for Scotland, allowing us to build a powerhouse economy and ensure a more equal society. They also provide an opportunity to secure better governance across the whole of the UK, and they will see a vote which I hope will reaffirm the place of Scotland and the place of the United Kingdom within the European Union. All of these outcomes are possible. None of them are guaranteed. They require positive argument. They require constructive negotiation from political leaders right across the UK. For my part, I'm determined that the Scottish Government will take the lead in making those arguments and contributing to those negotiations, because if we achieve these three objectives, it will be good for Scotland, it will be good, in my view, for every nation of the UK, and it will secure our place in Europe and the wider world. And by doing that, of course, it helps to strengthen our friendships and our alliances, both here in the heart of the United States and right across the world. So thank you very much indeed for listening, and I'm now thoroughly looking forward to the discussion that will follow.
So, First Minister, again, welcome, and thank you for talking with us. You said in your remarks, you raised the question about whether the Conservative Party victory in England, as you put it, is only one of the four nations. You said in only one of the four nations that were holding elections can be considered to have a mandate. So my first question to you is, if it's not a mandate, what is it? I mean, are you saying that David Cameron is not legitimately the leader of the UK?
No, I'm not saying that. The Constitution of the United Kingdom as it stands at present means that David Cameron is the Prime Minister. He won the election and got enough votes and enough seats across the UK to form a government, and that's what he has done. The point I'm making is a point of realpolitik. It's a point of political reality. Although, because of the relative size of England compared to the other nations of the United Kingdom, David Cameron is able to form a government. My argument is that he needs to accept that in the other three nations of the United Kingdom, his party did not win. And therefore, in how he governs the country, that's something that he should take account of, and he should respond to the democratic wishes as they were expressed in Scotland and Wales and in Northern Ireland. And in many respects, you know, how he and his government respond to that political reality will determine, at least in part, how the United Kingdom develops over the coming years. You know, for people in Scotland right now, we're watching quite carefully to see how David Cameron's government responds. If it responds well, then the message people will take is Westminster is responsive, it is adaptable, it can serve Scotland better. If it doesn't, then that message will be a very different one.
What is, I mean, are we to understand that there's a new relationship between Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom?
Scotland and the United Kingdom, the British Isles, you know, are part in that, regardless of whether Scotland becomes in the future, at some point in the future, an independent country or not, is always integral. But we have a reality in the United Kingdom is not and never has been a unitary state. It is a multinational family of four different nations. And in recent years, we've seen through devolution an asymmetry develop in how the United Kingdom is governed. We've seen different voting patterns, different priorities emerge in each of these four nations. And that does bring into sharp focus the relationship between a Scottish government and the United Kingdom government. And you know, I think it's a big test over the years to come of the United Kingdom, the construct that is the United Kingdom. Is it adaptable and responsive? Can it accommodate the different views and the different directions in which each of its nations wants to go in? Or will it prove to be unresponsive? In which case, perhaps, and I simply say perhaps, the United Kingdom will not continue as the construct that it is.
Watching from the other side of the Atlantic, I think many Americans look at what's going on over there and would say, well, if Scotland were to break away, were to become independent, that greatly weakens the United Kingdom. What do you say to that?
I've never held that view. And one of the things I've been talking about a lot this week in the United States is about, you know, if Scotland had become an independent country or if we ever do in the future. And, you know, I would stress the point I made in my opening remarks. There is no second independence referendum on the immediate horizon. So we're talking hypothetically at the moment. But, you know, the United States, for example, in that scenario, would go from having one close ally in the United Kingdom to having two close allies, Scotland and the remainder of the United Kingdom. I don't believe that weakens the United Kingdom in an international context. Scotland would always see as its closest ally, defending the security of the United Kingdom, contributing to the security in the rest of the world as England and the remainder of the United Kingdom. In many ways, you know, I think there is scope there to strengthen the position. And, you know, the United Kingdom, I think, can be strengthened by demonstrating how it responds to the will of people in its different constituent parts.
Well, in the meantime, while there is not an action right now to move toward independence, you clearly are looking at ways to have Scotland exert more authority over its own affairs. Your deputy leader, Stuart Hosey, said last night, was quoted today in The Scotsman as saying that the SNP is going to push for full fiscal autonomy, which, as we understand it, would mean complete control over tax and spending. Is this something that the SNP has decided to do?
That's the position of the SNP. Short of Scotland being independent, we want to have maximum powers in the Scottish Parliament. I'm very impressed that you've managed to read The Scotsman before I have this morning.
I have a feeling that's not so, but we'll see.
I could tell you it is so, but anyway. So yes, that is the position of the SNP. Now, as a devolved part of the United Kingdom, there are some restrictions on the devolution of tax powers. European Union rules, for example, would mean that VAT rates couldn't, value-added tax rates couldn't be set differently in Scotland. So there are some restrictions, but we want maximum fiscal powers within the United Kingdom context, short of Scotland being an independent country. Why do we want that? Not for its own sake, but because the more powers we have, the more fiscal responsibility we have, the more ability we have to shape things like our system of social security, the more able we will be to grow our economy, to make sure we're doing the things and pursuing the policies that help us to attract investment and create jobs and grow our economy faster and more sustainably. So it's powers and responsibilities for a purpose, and we'll make those arguments in the Westminster Parliament as the debate about further autonomy for Scotland continues over the weeks and months to come.
So you're not saying it's happening imminently? The push to have this fiscal autonomy?
Well, there is legislation going through the House of Commons right now. It's just started to extend the powers of the Scottish Parliament in what I would argue a reasonably limited way. So as part of that legislative process, we will seek to make amendments to extend the autonomy that is being proposed for the Scottish Parliament. And I think what you've been reading in The Scotsman today is about a particular amendment that we are pursuing in the House of Commons to give the Scottish Parliament the right to move to full fiscal autonomy.
So, and I'm sure you're aware of the analyses that show this would cost as much as $10 billion a year, cost Scotland that much. Is that a deterrent?
No, it's not. I mean, that analysis looks at the fiscal position of Scotland right now and finds that, not surprisingly, Scotland is in deficit, just as the UK is in deficit. Our revenues are not large enough to cover all of our spending. It's the position the United States is in. It's the position many countries across the world are in. So that's what that analysis is about. Now, countries that are in deficit want to pursue policies that grow their revenues through economic growth so that they can pay down their deficit and achieve fiscal balance. My argument for fiscal autonomy is that it equips the Scottish government with greater levers and greater powers and greater responsibility to do just that. So it introduces an ability for us to tackle the fact that we, like many other countries right now, are in a fiscal deficit position.
So I guess my question is, how much of a priority? Is this the first thing you're going to be pushing for in the coming weeks and months?
In terms of the constitutional debate, yes, we will be arguing that case for maximum powers for the Scottish Parliament. But as First Minister of Scotland, my priority on a daily basis as the leader of any government will be the economy in Scotland, how we grow jobs in Scotland, how we attract investment, how we make sure that our public services like our National Health Service and our education system are performing well and delivering quality services. So these are my daily preoccupations. But in terms of how the constitutional future of Scotland develops, we will be seeking to argue for as much autonomy for the Scottish Government as possible.
Is it a good thing if Scotland has its own foreign policy, do you think?
Well, if Scotland had been an independent country, we would have had responsibility for foreign policy as part of that. We're not in that position. Foreign policy remains the preserve of the United Kingdom government. But I do think it is good for an outward-looking internationalist country with an outward-looking internationalist government, as the one I lead is, to have a voice and to seek to influence the direction of UK foreign policy, and we will seek to do that. We'll seek to do that in a very constructive way. There are, you know, some differences in outlook on foreign policy between the Scottish Government and the UK Government, but there are many, many areas in which we share a view and in which the Scottish Government would be and are very supportive of the position of the UK Government. So we will seek to have our voice heard and to influence the direction of foreign policy as much as we can. But of course, it is at the moment the responsibility of the UK government.
So for an American audience, what's most important for us to understand, to the extent that it's important at all, what's important for us to understand about where are the similarities and where are the differences when it comes to relations with the United States? You've talked about the EU, your strong view that the UK should stay part of the EU, but what else, how would you flesh that out?
Well, what I would say about my party and my government and how we conduct ourselves on these matters within the United Kingdom and the European Union and the wider world is that we are internationalist and outward-looking. We would be, and if Scotland had voted to be independent, this would have been absolutely the case. We would consider ourselves to be a key ally of the United States. We want to work constructively within the world community to make sure that we are playing our part in resolving some of the conflicts and some of the issues of challenge that we live with in the modern world. We would want to be a continuing member of the NATO alliance to play our part in collective security. So the message that we very strongly articulated during the referendum and will continue to is the international community would have nothing to fear from an independent Scotland. We're not going to be independent right at the moment, but if that happens in the future, then the international community would find in Scotland a constructive and positive ally in terms of the many issues that we're dealing with and facing today.
What do you make, First Minister, of all the attention you've been getting since last month, really since last November, but most of all in the last few months?
I think it's good for Scotland. You know, there has been more international attention on Scotland as a country in the past 2 or 3 years than I can ever remember before. Now, last year we had a wonderful coincidence of different events. We hosted in the city of Glasgow the Commonwealth Games. A few weeks later, we hosted the Ryder Cup at Glen Eagles, big international sporting events that put the focus on Scotland. Most countries would have probably thought that was enough to be going on with for 1 year, but we decided we might get bored between the Commonwealth Games and the Ryder Cup, so we had a referendum on independence in between those two events. But all of that combined to put a spotlight on Scotland that I think in many ways continues to this day. And my view is a very simple one. We should capitalise on that. We should make the most of that. We should use that to encourage companies and business to invest in Scotland. And the message I've been taking around New York and Washington this week is that simple one. Scotland's a great place to live in, to work in, to do business in, to invest in. So if you're seeing Scotland on the television, reading about it in your newspapers, and you fancy finding out more, then please come to visit, come to invest, come to study, because we're a fantastic country for all of that.
So finally, before we take questions from the audience, are you getting done on this trip what you want to get done in this official trip to Washington?
Yes, I'm extremely happy with how this trip has gone. You know, let me just say, firstly, we've had a fantastic reception from everybody we have met in the United States, both in New York and Washington, and we're very grateful for that. But the focus of the trip has been largely trade and economy focused, and that's been very successful. I, in New York, met with two companies that were announcing new investment in Scotland. So from that point of view, it was very successful. But the other purpose has been to say very directly to a United States audience that Scotland sees itself as your friend and your ally and somebody that wants to work with you across a whole range of ways. And in that respect, I hope the visit has been successful in getting that message across.
So the US has nothing to fear from Scotland?
Nothing whatsoever. On the contrary.
All right. First Minister, let's take questions now from the audience. I would ask you to, I believe we have microphones. There's one. Maybe there's another one. Wait for the microphone. We would ask you to speak directly into it. We would ask you to stand up, give us your name, your affiliation, and let's see who wants to go first. I think over here, this gentleman.
Thank you, First Minister. Gavin Wilson with IFC. We met yesterday at the World Bank. The topic was economics, and I was wearing a World Bank hat. Today it's politics, and I can ask a personal question. I'm an Anglo-Scot. If I was forced to choose a passport, I would choose a Scottish one. But I was born in London, and I want to ask you a question about political legitimacy you mentioned regarding the current government of the UK. London has a larger population than Scotland, and the Conservatives lost the election in London as well. So one question is, are the Conservatives legitimate rulers of London in the same way you mentioned of Scotland? And secondly, my wife's family are partly from Orkney. Orkney is a small part of Scotland, has a very distinct identity. And if Scotland were independent, would it be legitimate for Orkney to say they would like to be independent from Scotland? And is your government in Scotland the legitimate government of Orkney, given what you said about territorial differences in terms of votes and a political affiliation?
Okay. Thank you for that question. Orkney.
Should we say two questions?
Orkney, of course, being one of only three parts of Scotland that didn't vote SNP at the general election. But I have to say, it came close. So maybe in the future we'll be able to change that. Look, let me be very clear about this. In a strict constitutional sense, the government of the UK, you know, is legitimate in every part of the UK. I don't question that. I'm making a political point about the need for, in a multinational state of different nations voting in different ways, a sensible government will be responsive to that. And David Cameron and his government will demonstrate that they understand that whether they like it or not, people in Scotland didn't vote for his government and will, through their policies and their approach and their demeanour towards Scotland, demonstrate that they understand that. So that's the point I'm making. London, of course, has its own mayor, its own devolved government in that sense. But the wider point, and this relates to your point about Orkney as well, you know, I make a very sharp distinction, and I think most people in the United Kingdom would make this distinction as well, between nations and regions of the United Kingdom. Scotland is a nation, as is England, Wales and Northern Ireland. And you know, I think that brings a particular significance and importance to the different voting patterns and the different constitutional positions of these nations within the United Kingdom. In terms of Orkney, and I spent a fair bit of time in both Orkney and Shetland in the run-up to the independence referendum. I've been there since then as well. There is no great appetite in Orkney or Shetland, if Scotland was to become independent, for them to be independent from Scotland. I'm not saying you will not find anybody there of that opinion, but contrary to how it's occasionally presented in the United Kingdom and particularly Scottish media, you will not find a great clamour to break away from Scotland in either Orkney or Shetland. What you do find within both of those islands and our other islands is a desire for greater autonomy. And the Scottish Government actually right now is in the process of looking at what powers and responsibilities we devolve from Edinburgh to our island communities to give them greater autonomy, and in a sense giving life to the belief we have in decentralised government and power lying as close to people as possible. But to wrap that up, you know, my point here is not to say David Cameron is not a legitimate Prime Minister as far as Scotland is concerned. Now, whether I want him to be or not is neither here nor there. In a constitutional sense, he is. But the political reality means that if he simply acts as if he's got the same mandate in every part of the UK, then I don't think he will be acting in a way that is strengthening the UK. On the contrary, I think he'll be acting in a way that is ultimately going to weaken the UK in that respect.
Okay, over here, yes, in front.
I'm Charlie Stevenson. I teach at SAIS. Since you've opened the door to what a Scottish foreign policy would be, what are your views on what the UK policy should be toward Ukraine and Iraq and Syria?
Well, we're, and this is a good example on these issues of where the Scottish Government supports the UK position on Ukraine and Russia. We're supportive of the international community's position. We're supportive of the sanctions against Russia and have been a voice of support within the UK for the government's position and a voice of support wider than that for the international community's position. Similarly on ISIL and Syria, Iraq, we support the efforts of the international community. The ISIL threat is one of the severest threats that not just the Middle East faces, but the wider world as well, because of the implications of that. So do not think that the SNP and the Scottish Government takes a markedly different position from the UK government on the vast majority of international issues. We don't. We are a responsible participant in or responsible voice when it comes to these matters, and on both of these issues you will not find any great difference between our position and the position of the United Kingdom government.
Can you foresee a point though when you might take a different position? Obviously you've mentioned the
EU,
but I mean what
my party wasn't in government at this point in our recent history, but my party took a very different view over the war in Iraq in the 2003 invasion of Iraq. We opposed that conflict. So there are some issues where we have taken a different view. There may well be issues in the future where we take a different view. But you know, if the war in Iraq, we were not alone in the international community in terms of countries that thought the invasion of Iraq and what followed on from that was the wrong direction to take. But we would always be and always will be a responsible voice in terms of these international issues.
Right here in the front row. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Marisa Lino with Northrop Grumman. I think, should there be in the future an independent Scotland, I think one of the greatest concerns in the US is how the defense structure would be disentangled. And I wonder if you would speak about your vision for how defense would be handled if Scotland were to be independent.
Well, we set out in the referendum campaign last year in very significant detail how an independent Scotland would configure its defence forces and how those defence forces would then work and cooperate with defence forces across the rest of the United Kingdom, the European Union and internationally. If you have an interest in that, I'd be happy before we go to take your details and I can send you the work we did around that. An independent Scotland, if we had voted to become independent, would have established our own defence forces, army, navy and air force. It would have taken a period of years to make that transition. But notwithstanding the distinct defence forces an independent Scotland would have established, they would have inevitably worked very, very closely and in a very integrated way with the defence forces of the rest of the United Kingdom. You know, Britain is an island. The defence of Scotland is important to the defence of England. The defence of England is important to the defence of Scotland. And it is inconceivable in any future constitutional arrangement that the defence forces of each part of the United Kingdom would not work together very cohesively. The difference of opinion between the Scottish Government and the United Kingdom Government on defence, and I absolutely respect the fact this is a difference of opinion between the Scottish Government and the United States Government as well, is over the future of the UK's nuclear deterrent. My party does not support the nuclear deterrent and does not support the renewal of the Trident nuclear deterrent. Now, partly that is a disagreement, an honest disagreement in principle. But in part, it's also a very practical concern that we have about the implications for our conventional defence forces of a decision to renew the Trident nuclear deterrent. There have been significant reductions in the UK's conventional defence footprint over the past 10 years. There is a very current debate, which I know the President of the United States is intensely interested in, about the percentage of GDP that is spent on defence in the United Kingdom. And one of the concerns we have is the more that defence expenditure is taken up with Trident, the less expenditure we have on the conventional forces that the country really needs to secure itself and to contribute to defence internationally. I mean, one example I often use, which illustrates and highlights what I think is almost a neglect of our conventional defence forces, is around maritime surveillance. As I said a moment ago, Britain is an island. To Scotland, maritime protection and surveillance is very important. You know, we've got a large oil industry, fishing industry, so these maritime interests are extremely important to us. The UK doesn't have any maritime patrol aircraft. So towards the end of last year, when there was suspicion that Russian submarines were patrolling in our territorial waters, we did not have within our own forces the capability to deal with that. We had to draw on help from elsewhere. So my view is we need strong, appropriate conventional forces that are capable of defending the United Kingdom, but also contributing positively and appropriately to international efforts as well.
Let's see. I'm trying to go back and forth across the room. Right there. Yes.
Diana Negroponte, the Woodrow Wilson Institute. First Minister, with the decline of the hydrocarbon resources in the North Sea and the decline in employment in the energy and energy services, what are the areas that you see as the potential sources of prosperity in the next 5 years? And how willing are you to accept new migrants, whether they be from within the 28 or North Africa, to participate in those new areas of productivity?
Okay, thank you very much indeed. That's a very good question. Scotland's oil and gas resource, like the oil and gas resources of other countries that are blessed to have those natural resources, are, you know, they are finite resources. That said, oil and gas will continue to be a considerable source of revenue for Scotland and for the United Kingdom for many, many years to come. There is estimated to be up to 24 billion barrels of extractable oil left in the North Sea. So it's an industry that has a good, strong future ahead of it. But you're absolutely correct that it is a finite resource. Scotland is in the very lucky position, of course, of not simply being an oil-producing country. We also happen to have some of Europe's best and biggest potential around renewable energy. So we're also a leader when it comes to wind energy, wave and tidal energy, and some of the new technologies around low-carbon energy sources. So that's a growth area for Scotland and an area that we are investing in and encouraging greatly. We're also very lucky to have a number of strong sectors in our economy that I would suggest are growth sectors of the future. So the key strength of the Scottish economy, other than energy, would be life sciences, where we are, you know, a world leader, creative industries, our food and drink exports, which are enjoyed by many in the United States and many other countries across the world. So one of the things I think it's important to understand about the Scottish economy is, notwithstanding oil and gas tends to be very associated with the Scottish economy, our economy is not dependent on oil and gas. We have a rich and diverse economy and, as I say, world-leading capability in many of the sectors that are the growth sectors of the future. I was one of the companies I spoke about having met in New York that just announced an investment in Scotland as a United States company active in the space sector. They manufacture nanosatellites. They've just announced a major investment in Scotland because that's one of the other areas where Scotland is seen to have, through the skills that our universities are producing, a real competitive advantage. One of the things we're doing, which doesn't make us unique, but it is very important, is increasingly, we're lucky in Scotland, we've got per head of population more at top universities than any other country in the world apart from Switzerland. So we're in a very good position in terms of the quality of our education, but increasingly our universities and our business sector are working hand in glove to make sure that we're able to maximise those competitive advantages we've got. And briefly on immigration, Scotland welcomes immigration and we welcome migrant workers to Scotland. There are considerable numbers of Polish people and people from other European Union member states living in and working in Scotland. Actually, notwithstanding the debate that is very, very active in the UK just now and associated with the European Union membership question, European Union migrants to the United Kingdom make a net positive contribution to our economy. And that is true of Scotland as well. So we welcome immigration that can help with the task of growing our economy. We've got in Scotland an organisation called Talent Scotland, where that as a public organisation helps companies scour the world looking for talent that can then fill skill shortages in some of our key sectors. So we're an open economy and we're an open society, and we welcome very much the contribution that workers from outside Scotland make to our economy.
Okay. Here we go, in the very back there.
Hi, good morning. I'm Stefan Grober with Euronews European Television. Does it rankle you that you were not received in the White House while every member of the royal family that is in this town has an appointment in the Oval Office?
No. not in the slightest. Like I said earlier on, and I'll say again, we've had a fantastic reception in the United States this week, and the courtesy shown towards me, towards the Scottish Government, has been fantastic, but also the genuine interest in Scotland and where we stand within the United Kingdom, within the European Union, within the wider world has been absolutely first class. So I have no complaints and no rankles at all with anything associated with my visit here this week.
Let's see, right there, third row back.
Mm-hmm. Nelson Cunningham with McLarty Associates. A family legend has the Cunninghams are from Ayrshire, but it's been some centuries, so I'm not going to ask you about the independence movement in Ayrshire. Instead, my question has to do with monetary issues. What currency would an independent Scotland wish to have?
Okay. I hail from Ayrshire. It's my home in Scotland. It's where I come from, so I can report back that the independence movement in Ayrshire is alive and well and prospering. The proposition on currency that we put forward during the independence referendum was that an independent Scotland would continue to use sterling. We would continue to use the British pound, partly because it is our currency. It's our currency now, and there's no reason why it wouldn't continue to be our currency in the future. Some people say, and it was a hotly debated issue in the independence referendum. I won't go into all of the ins and outs of it, but many people will say, how could Scotland and England as independent countries share a currency? Look what's happening in the Eurozone. I think the key point to put across there is that, and I'm overly simplifying here, but the problems in the Eurozone, come from partly the fact that the poorest parts of Greece and the richest parts of Germany and everything in between have been shoehorned into one currency. That's not the position that would have been the case in the scenario of an independent Scotland. The economies of Scotland and England are very closely aligned. We would have been what many economists would have termed an optimal currency zone, levels of productivity, levels of employment, very, very similar. So my belief now is that not only should Scotland continue to use the British pound if we became independent, but it would be workable and perfectly viable and perfectly successful for us to do so.
So there won't be a new Scottish mint to...
Well, we have our own Scottish banknotes. The Scottish clearing banks already produce Scottish banknotes. So if you go to the United Kingdom and you happen to go to Scotland, you'll get a pound note. It's worth exactly the same as the one you'll get in England, but it will have its own Scottish stamp on it.
All right. Yes, right here. Woman in the second row.
Thank you, First Minister. Fiona Hill from the Brookings Institution. You've spoken really eloquently on so many issues here, and I think there's one area where people are really looking to Scotland within the United Kingdom, here and internationally, which is on this very issue that you expressed about being an open economy, an open society. and a country that's trying to play a very responsible role in governance, and especially in conflict. I mean, as you well know, there's a lot of scrutiny on Scotland now about this very question that you raised about Scotland being a nation and not just a region. We have elections coming up in Spain at the end of this year, where the question about Catalonia and its independence will be raised. And in fact, the conflict between Russia and Ukraine is on what is a region and what is a nation. And I think that the question that you heard earlier was really getting at that, rather than just at the legitimacy. It's how, in a modern era where you have so much immigration, as you said, Scotland has a lot of immigrants, a lot of people who wouldn't hail back to Ayrshire or Orkney or anywhere. And Scots have a migrant nation themselves in the United States and all over England as well. It's not just the Scots, you know, born recently, but many generations of Scots have moved about for hundreds of years. How in this modern age, where it's very difficult to define a nation, it's not just on language anymore, can Scotland actually play a role as a model of how to resolve many of these conflicts and deal with these issues of governance? And one of the big issues in the United Kingdom itself is, I think there's been a lot of concerns in Ireland and in Northern Ireland about the future of the peace process and what would happen if Scotland did become independent. So I'm just really wondering how you can address this issue. It's not just a question of being a nation. What does a nation mean in a modern context, and how can Scotland really actually be a model mm-hmm. for a lot of these other conflicts globally?
Yeah, I think that's a very, very good question. And the contribution Scotland can make in the area you're talking about here is not to, you know, intervene or start to express opinions about whether Catalonia should be independent or not, but it should lead by example in how we conduct these debates and how we seek to settle and resolve them, as we did in the independence referendum last year. I mean, to get to the heart of your question, what is a nation in the modern world? Well, Scotland's in the happy position of its territory not being disputed. The borders of Scotland, the nation, are well understood and well settled and agreed without any real dispute. So the territorial limits of the nation of Scotland are understood. But of course, what is a nation is a more complex question. And this is where Scottish nationalism, if I can use that term, which is often a pejorative term with negative connotations, it's where Scottish nationalism offers a positive role model for the rest of the world. Because my definition of what it means to be Scottish, I mean, the nation, the territorial limits of the nation are well defined, but what it means to be Scottish, in my view, is whether or not you choose to live there. So if you choose to live in Scotland, if you choose to make Scotland your home, it doesn't matter to me whether you come from England, the United States, Pakistan, India, Poland, or any other part of the world. If Scotland is your home, if you live there, if you work there, if you make a contribution, you are Scottish and have as much right as I do to influence the future direction of the country. So in the independence referendum, Polish migrants who were living in Scotland had a vote. They were allowed to vote in the referendum, just as people who live in Scotland but were born in England or any other part of the European Union had the right to vote. So that's the civic approach to nationalism that is absolutely at the heart of the SNP's approach to this question. And what does that do for the rest of the world? It demonstrates, and I think our referendum experience demonstrated this very powerfully, that you can resolve these complex questions of nationhood, of governance, of identity in an entirely peaceful and democratic fashion. And that's the example we hold up to the rest of the world. The issue of Scottish independence has been debated with, you know, an ebb and flow in intensity for 300 years since Scotland became part of the Union. That question has never gone away. It's always been there. As I say, it's come and gone in terms of its level of intensity. But in modern times, not a single drop of blood has been shed in that debate on either side. What a fantastic example to set for the rest of the world. So that's what we offer. It's not for us to say in any other part of the world whether a particular people or particular nation should opt to do as we do and argue to be independent. But in terms of the process of determining these things, we should absolutely fly the flag for how we've chosen to do it.
What about the other part of her question about the effect on the Northern Ireland peace process?
Oh, sorry, the Northern Ireland peace process. This was an issue that occasionally was talked about during the referendum campaign. I do not believe, and you know, I don't think there are many people in Northern Ireland or indeed across the rest of the UK who would seriously have argued that a vote for Scottish independence would have compromised the peace process. Now, I don't want to undermine or diminish the challenges that Northern Ireland still faces and, you know, periodically will face, but the peace process, fortunately and thankfully, is very well established in Northern Ireland. And I think all of us, in whatever part of the United Kingdom we happen to live in, whatever our views on the constitutional future of the United Kingdom, are absolutely committed to making sure that peace process continues to be successful. One of the features of the peace process in the Good Friday Agreement was the establishment of a forum across the British Isles called the British Irish Council. I'll be attending a meeting of the British Irish Council in Dublin next week, to the end of next week. The British Irish Council brings together the Republic of Ireland, the United Kingdom, the three devolved administrations of Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland, and the Crown dependencies of Isle of Man, Jersey, Guernsey. And, you know, that gives life to the British Isles and how we seek to cooperate and foster dialogue within the British Isles. You know, interestingly, if Scotland had become an independent country, we would still have been part of the British Isles and would still have operated in that forum. We would just have gone from being a devolved member of the British Irish Council to an independent member. So that is a very strong representation of how those kind of arrangements can work, and itself was one of the outcomes of the peace process in Northern Ireland. So that, I'm glad to say, is something that I think we all agree on, that the importance of that peace process and its continuation is beyond and above any of these other debates.
Another question? Let's see here, and then I'll go to the back.
Hi, my name is Stephen Claremont. I work for an organization called Every Child Matters. And recently, the United States Congress has been considering welfare reform, and leadership has been very open at looking into the UK as a model, particularly universal credit, and a lot of the reforms implemented by the Conservative Cameron government. Sort of, what is your perspective on that, and what should US policymakers be worried about and sort of unintended consequences of looking to that as a model?
Don't do it, would be my advice. I think you've got to draw a distinction between the theory of welfare reform in the United Kingdom and the practice of welfare reform. In theory, universal credit is bringing together all the different social security benefits into one single payment and making sure that that operates in a way that as people move into work, they don't fall off a cliff in terms of the benefits that are clawed away, you know, outweighing the benefits they get from starting to earn. So in theory, it's a good idea, but it's not working that way in practice because the process of reform has been accompanied by a very significant cut on expenditure. So what you've found as the new systems have come into place is that the expenditure cuts have meant that some of the people that have been intended to benefit from welfare reform have actually been some of the biggest losers. And, you know, the rhetoric of the United Kingdom government is they're being tough on people who don't want to work, people who want to, you know, skive and shirk responsibility and lie in their beds all day while the rest of us are out working. And, you know, don't get me wrong, I don't think these people should get an easy ride on the welfare system either. But that's not the reality of what has happened. And there's lots of research, if you're interested, to back this up. The people who have suffered in the last couple of years the most from welfare reform in the United Kingdom have been people with disabilities. Disabled benefits have been significantly cut. Single parents, and particularly women, and those in employment but on low wages, they have, between them, taken the biggest hit. So you may have something to learn from the theory of UK welfare reform. I would argue that you should shy away from some of the practical application of that.
All right, question in the back.
Hi, Astrid Kimball from Google. On your comments about Scotland's independence movement being a model in terms of the peaceful nature, I'm just curious on your thoughts. Did social media or the internet or technology play a role that was different now than in the past in this particular movement?
Social media played a massive role in the independence referendum in Scotland. It was a good role and, at the margins, perhaps a less good role, and I'll come on to that in a second, but in the positive, it opened up, it helped to open up the debate to many, many more people than that would otherwise have taken part. So you had, in the referendum, a population that was just naturally more keen to get engaged because it was a big issue and a big question and a big responsibility for everybody to decide how they were going to vote. So you had that desire to be engaged. What social media did was give people the means to be much more engaged. They could access information in a way that suited them. They could often find exactly what they were wanting to know about in a way that they wouldn't otherwise have been able to do, and people shared views and shared information in a way that wouldn't have been possible without Facebook and Twitter and social media generally. So it was a positive, in my view. Social media, and this is not unique to the referendum, social media has got a downside because it gives to a minority, and it is a minority in Scotland and in the UK and I'm sure in the United States as well, but a minority of more extreme opinion that is not very tolerant of other people's views and just wants to hurl abuse at people that don't agree with them. That minority of people have always been there, but social media now gives them a platform to communicate with the wider world that they wouldn't previously have had. And occasionally in the referendum, it appeared as if that minority was bigger than it was, and it you know, at times threatened to kind of taint the atmosphere. Now, I don't think it did overall, but sometimes that was the danger and risk. So that's the downside of social media, but I think it's hugely outweighed by the positive. And it did have a big role in the referendum, and it, you know, continues to have a, you know, almost transformational role in terms of the democratic engagement that we're now seeing in Scotland around elections as well.
So we have time for one more question. And just reminding everybody, this has been on the record. I think that's been obvious, but yes, sir, right here.
Oh, now you tell me.
My name is Jerry Livingston from the German Historical Institute. I'm not sure I should pose this question. Our family was banished from Scotland in 1662 after the restoration of Charles II. But nevertheless, my question relates to the Scottish diaspora in this country, Canada, Australia, and elsewhere. Is there more that can be done to mobilize the diaspora, the Scottish diaspora, for the interests of Scotland? I mean, the Irish are very good in this country in mobilizing their diaspora. Can Scotland do the same?
Yeah. Can I say, firstly, I'm very sorry you were banished from Scotland. And as First Minister now, I hereby formally lift the ban. Okay? You're welcome back anytime you like. And I'll greet you at the airport, just to underline that. It's a very good question, sir. Yeah, I mean, the diaspora, Scottish diaspora in the United States alone is enormous and hugely powerful and influential. I was joking last night at we had a reception at the embassy that some of you might have been at. There are more people in this country who claim to be Scottish than there are in Scotland. You know, we've got a population of 5 million. There are, I think, official estimates, and they're probably an underestimate, say that there are 10 million people in the United States who claim a Scottish connection. So the diaspora is hugely important. We're working incredibly hard to mobilise and use the talents and the skills and the influence and the networks of the diaspora to fly the flag for Scotland and capitalise on the profile of Scotland. We have an office here in Washington. Kate, here in the front row, if you want to connect with her before the end, works in that office. So we're working very hard to do that. We've got a network on the trade side called Global Scots. If MD here wants to be a Global Scot, please feel free to come forward to do that formally in terms of the business community and trade. But, you know, albeit we're working hard at that and doing very well through our staff here, we can do much more. So if anybody here who has Scottish connections, a Scottish background, or who just wishes they were Scottish, then please feel free. Please feel free to offer your services. We'd be delighted to take you up on it.
So Scots of America, rise up. Is that the...
Absolutely.
Please join me in thanking the First Minister and I would just ask you to keep your seats until she leaves the room.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.